Welcome back. The SGX Nifty has recovered 9 points in the green now, though Asia is still in the red. Crude's at 66.88. So let's keep an eye on all these parameters. Mr. Tulsyan is still with us. Mr. Tulsyan, a couple of mid-cap stocks. CG Power, where of course you've had a positive view, but the last three-day rally has been big. And also, what did you make of the move in Bajaj Consumer and that promoter selling?
See, Anuj, first coming on CG Power, in fact, I have been maintaining my positive view when it corrected to 23-24 rupees, you know, post the disappointing Q3 numbers. And if you see the developments, in fact, I've said this couple of days back also, if you see the developments, I think the promoters who were seen to be little lethargy in monetizing their other overseas units, like Hungary and all that, is seen now catching up. And in fact, they've say, released a statement saying that the other discontinued operations have turned, you know, the overseas operations which were taken as discontinued operations have turned EBITDA positive and will now be taken as a continued operations going forward, and don't expect a loss of more than 200 crore to be seen in Q4, which is again a comforting statement. So the things are seen quite positive on the going ahead, and I have been taking a valuation call that if you take a company's enterprise value, 2300 crore market cap, 2300 crore debt, or maybe 2500 crore, it works out to 5000 crore on standalone operational performance of maybe 6000 crore top line. You don't get a company, a capital goods makers, you know, with a EV of less than one on sales, while the other capital goods companies are ruling at a EV to sales of maybe 4x 5x 6x. I'm not comparing them with the leading ones. So yes, the things are seen quite positive on the valuation fronts. And I'm hopeful, and in fact, I've said that, you know, when the share was ruling 35, 36, that won't be surprised to see the share giving 100% return in next 12 to 18 months as well. And coming on Bajaj Consumer, I think this is seen to be a positive move because the company is not seen to be doing quite well under the present management of Shishir Bajaj. And if the stake sale happens, or, you know, having seen that, that will be seen positive for the company.
Okay. Mr. Tulsyan, I also wanted your thoughts on how to approach Zee Entertainment now. I mean, it's recovered almost 45% from the lows that it hit less than 2 months ago. Is there more upside here?
See, Sonia, on every fall of Zee Entertainment, I have been giving a buy call. And when it fell to a level of 320, 325, I remember, at that time also we have been giving. Because it's an excellent asset. And when you see the monetizations likely to happen maybe in the next 1 month or so, as per the timeline given by the management, because they have said April end. So take about 45 days or maybe a couple of months, you know, going forward. And we have been taking a call that the deal is likely to happen at least at 525 to 540 per share, which will trigger the open offer also. And that will see the re-rating of the stock in a very big way. If any overseas investor comes in as a new promoter, that will be seen quite positive. And we won't be surprised to see the share moving to those levels, you know, at the deal at which it will happen. Because the institutional investors are having a lot of confidence in the assets, and actually the company or the you cannot create the similar company maybe in the decades also. So yes, keeping extremely positive view, risk reward is seen quite favorable. If you have a downside maybe at 440, 450, you have the potential to share to move up to 520, 525 as well in the next couple of months.
Okay, sir. We're just coming back to you. The markets have opened and the dollar is a little more expensive at 69.74. Yesterday we saw it become as cheap as 69.50, 55 at a point. And then maybe there was some intervention. It ended up at 69.70 and today at 69.74. So some initial weakness, which we saw in other Asian currencies, is also spreading on to India. But you don't see any such weakness at the moment, at least in the Nifty trade, the Nifty indices. Index itself has started 0.25% higher at 11,330. And likewise, Sensex up about 0.25%. But let's wait and see. It's still difficult to gauge the mood of the market. Some of the metal stocks are losing, like JSW Steel and Vedanta, because globally, like there is a risk off in equity, there is a risk off in commodities as well. So metals are showing that. iShares and Asian Paints, NTPC, HUL are all still going strong and supporting the index. So positive at this point in time. Let's wait and see how things pan out.
Okay, a couple of more stocks that you'd want to perhaps look at. DLF, on the back of that CLSA upgrade, is a stock that's looking pretty good this morning. It's up almost about 4.5%. You have a couple of these names from the auto ancillary space. JK Tyres is picking up quite a bit. And other real estate companies like HDIL are also trading in the green at the moment. But we'll wait by for these rates to settle. Prakash Gaba, any thoughts on any real estate stocks? I mean, in the very near term, would you trade them on the long side?
Yesterday when I was looking at it, Sonia, I was liking DLF, and DLF certainly is looking good. It can climb to around 200 zones, a matter of time. Seen a good momentum and should continue. I think I would have stopped somewhere below 180 on DLF and trade long.
Okay. Well, we'll have to wait for the markets to settle down at this point in time. Mr. Tulsian, the other big theme that people could play could be the rural recovery. We got a little bit of an endorsement of that yesterday. The food disinflation, which we have been seeing, flattened out. Yesterday, the food inflation numbers for February were same as that of February of 2018. So the severe fall appears to have gotten arrested. Do you think there are some rural-facing themes that we can play?
Lata, I think in the time to come, a lot of this rural theme will really be catching up quite fast. And in fact, we have been, though we have been seeing the FMCG, all the stocks are so seen ruling quite rich, maybe in the P multiple of 40 to 55, whether you talk of Asia, Britannia, or you talk of HUL, or you talk of Nestle, Godrej Consumer. I'm not touching on that, but I think the one theme which is really seen catching up is the consumer durables, in which you can include the air conditioners also, because of the expected to be the severe heat this time, because this time we have seen severe cold. Environmentalist or the prediction comes that we will be seeing the severe heat and we will be seeing the good monsoon, because if you have this three seasons to be seen in consecutively, you know, good this one at an upper end. So yes, the theme of the consumer durables, including air conditioners, you know, which is always forms a part of that segment, that sector only, seem to be quite positive, and we are keeping an eye on that sector.
Okay. Sir, also, what are your thoughts on Escorts? Yesterday, it had a really strong run in late trade. And I mean, we've discussed this in the past, but the stock has gone from 600 to 800 in, you know, less than 2 months. Any thoughts here?
See, Sonia, actually January and February are seen to be the lowest months for the tractor sales, and March is again seen to be better months, because you see the interim, you know, harvesting happening on 13th April, and you know, ahead of that we see the sales picking up. So yes, the March sales are of the tractor sales, particularly of Escorts, though the Mahindra and Mahindra is not able to capitalize on that. But I think Escorts monthly sales for March will really be seen quite good. In fact, January and February also has shown the growth, while the Mahindra and Mahindra has shown degrowth in the month of February. So I think after, once we see the March sales numbers, and yesterday also I said that I won't be surprised to see the share moving to about 870, 875. So maybe in the next couple of weeks, or maybe next 21 days, by the time we will be seeing the monthly sales number for March, because March is again for 31 days. Again, you know, seem to be better months than January and February. And overall, the Q4 numbers are likely to be better, because this yearly growth on the monthly sales for January and February has also been seen. And apart from that, construction and railway equipment division is also seen to be doing quite well. So overall, we are keeping extremely positive on Escorts, in spite of having risen by about 25% or 30% in this last 2-3 months. The share has potential to move up further by about 8 to 10%. By the time we will see monthly sales numbers on 1st April for the month of March.
Okay. Well, just to come back to the fixed income markets, the dollar rupee, after opening at 69.74, has come back to 69.66. So there is a pressure of going long rupee and selling the dollar even now. I mean, so much of dollars have come, so there will be people with positions wanting to still short the dollar. Mm. The bond yields have risen a smidge. Like 2-3 basis points, and opening at 7.54, but they quickly went down to 7.52. But still, the big message from inflation has been that it has troughed out, whether you look at food disinflation or whether you look at core inflation. It looks like any more lower and lower inflation numbers are out, and maybe that's what the market is adjusting a little to. The stock markets at the moment are continuing to hold. I mean, when I say stock markets, I mean the Nifty, continuing to hold a 0.25% rally. Anuj, you think that this can still be a green day?
Yeah, I mean, it looks like for starters it should be, because the first, you know, just like, you know, 2 weeks back, your intuition was to sell any kind of rally or any kind of flat move. Right now, the intuition would be to buy that move. But you would want to keep an eye on the Asian screen today and crude, because if that part is changing a bit, then it, you know, there could be some property.
Okay, well, for now, the market has settled with a gain of about 0.2%. And in the broader markets, plenty of stocks are looking good. Jet Airways is on the downside. Apart from all the news flow, four more of their aircrafts have been grounded. And on the upside, you have a couple of these names like DLF. In fact, talking about DLF, Sonal is here with us to tell us what CLSA has made of DLF. In fact, there's a big upgrade coming in this morning. Hi, Sonal.
Hi, Sonia. Good morning. As you rightly pointed out, there's a big upgrade coming in for CLSA for DLF. They've upgraded it to a buy from a sell. They've also increased the target price to 229 versus 167 earlier. And they've turned bullish on the company because after quarters of reporting negative cash flows, now the company in last 2-3 quarters has turned cash flow positive and they expect this trend to continue. They expect it to be sustainable. In fact, they're very bullish on the leasing business as well. They expect the rental business to deliver a double-digit growth in times to come. And they also say that the company is set to cross lease rentals of around $500 million by FY21. On the development side, they say that since the company is expecting net debt free levels by end of this year, they expect it to be good. And also, since the company has done well on part of delivering their projects in the NCR region, it is the sole company that is doing well in a dead NCR market. And that is why they are bullish on the company. Back to you.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. Well, a very strong vote coming in for DLF. But then the stock moved yesterday. So, I don't know. Okay, at the moment, it is starting with a 1.4% uptick. Let's wait and see how things pan out. Mr. Tulsian, Reliance, that's been spearheading the markets higher. Is it still good to go? 1330 and counting?
See, Lata, actually, I've said yesterday that if you are keeping the 6 months view, then extremely positive on Reliance, no need to worry. But near term, because I'm keeping the cautious view on the market for next 3 days, that is today, tomorrow and day after, because having reached so much. And if you see, the Reliance has been, you know, had a great contribution in this rally. We have seen 255 points rally in last couple of days. And in Reliance, I think in last 10 days have risen from about 1240, 1245 to 1330, which we have seen yesterday and which is seen its near term resistance also. And again, you know, because of the cautious view on the soft GRM margins, you know, looking to the Singapore benchmark, probably I won't be surprised to see the share correcting back. It's difficult to give a timeline whether that happens in these 3 days or maybe next 1 week. But I think that near-term peak out has happened in two stocks, ICICI Bank and Reliance Industries. Obviously, as an investor, if you are an investor, remain invested with a long-term view. No need to worry. But from the near-term and short-term investor and trading point of view, I won't be surprised to see the share correcting to 1270 to 1280 in this series itself, maybe in the next couple of weeks.
All right, Mr. Tulsian, we thank you there today. Thanks a lot. I'll talk to you in closing bell now about some more stocks. For now, the pre-open settled 25 points higher on the Nifty, 36 points higher on the Bank Nifty. Let's take the 9-10 calls. Sudarshan, you reckon this minor gap up would be profit-taking opportunity? You won't chase it? And what's your 9-10 call?
Well, yes, for me, it's a profit-taking opportunity. Wonderful that the markets will open higher. But I won't chase this. And it is expected that this market will become choppy, whether now or in the afternoon. Sun Pharma is a buying opportunity. It's a very attractive chart. So buy with a stop at 462 and a target of 480.
Okay, Mitesh, okay. Your 9-10 call?
I would choose a long on ICICI Bank, keep a stop at or just below 380 and look for targets close to about 400.
Okay, long on ICICI. It's open that way. Prakash,
I'll go for HUL. I think it's heading to 1760 zone. Stop below 1720 should be okay on HUL.
Okay, that's HUL. In fact, talking about consumption, or rather at least the ancillary space, yesterday a lot of stocks like Bata, Havells, etc. hit fresh highs. Sudarshan, quick thoughts on Havells if you track that one. It's moved from 560 to 800 over the last couple of months.
It has, and it just broke out to new highs, as you said yesterday. I think for a short-term trader, you have to wait and for a dip, and these dips will come. For an investor, you can buy at any price.
Okay. Gentlemen, we are coming back to you. An important set of cues are coming from the commodity space. Manisha Gupta has joined in. Good morning, Manisha.
Morning, Lata. Thank you for that. Well, yes, we have seen the crude oil prices trade at a three-week highs. There are three factors that are keeping the prices higher. One is the U.S. crude output growth. IEA says that, yes, we will see further record highs in U.S. production. But for 2019, the U.S. output growth is expected to slow down. And the max that we will see is 12.3 million barrels per day. We already are at 12.1. So that is one positive factor. The other is that Saudis continue to make statements in the international media saying that the output for the month month of April will be below 10 million and the exports will fall below 7 million barrels per day. So that has been yet another positive. And the API data shows a decline in the U.S. weekly inventories. That's yet again another reason that is keeping the prices on the higher side. So a seventh straight session that we have seen crude oil prices continue to gain up. It is yet another day positive for the metal space as well, as you are looking at the China pledging more stimulus. The earlier stimulus measures clearly are showing their way into the current Chinese economic data. You also are looking at suspension of a key port from Vale. That has taken the steel prices up by 1% in Shanghai. Iron ore prices have rebounded as well. And then it also is about the marginally weak US dollar index. That seems to be supportive as well. So after nearly 1 to 2% gains overnight in the metal prices, Asia really seems to be looking at some follow-through buying.
Okay, well, thanks a lot for that, Manisha. We'll see you again later in the day. Two more minutes to go before the markets open for the day. And after the big move yesterday, all indications are that perhaps we could see some more upsides. Prakash Gaba, what are your thoughts on some of these pharma names making a bit of a comeback? In fact, you know, this month, Sun Pharma is up almost about 10-odd%. Cipla is indicating a start in the green. Would you trade any of these names now?
I think Sun Pharma was certainly looking good to me when I looked at it last time. Yes, looks like it can go up. The momentum is very good. I think it's heading to closer to around 500 zone, but that's too far away. So in the short term, around 480, 82 should be fine. Stop below 460 on Sun Pharma is better. Cipla, I would avoid it.
Okay. Sudarshan, I wanted to ask you about PSU banks. My guess was that a little more of the wearing down of long positions should happen today. Is there a trade, long or short or any?
Well, yes, the trade is to still be long in PSU banks, but given the fact that the Nifty itself could be choppy, you have to buy them on dips, but they are likely to outperform private banks for the next few days.
Okay. All right. Buy them still for the next few days. Obviously, an allied question is on NBFCs as well. Mitesh, any trades on any of the NBFCs, long or short?
Rather, not any fresh entry. I think, you know, we've been recommending Bajaj Finance, L&T Finance, etc. But not immediately. I think some pullback and then I would look at them.
Okay. But at the moment, the markets are in a standstill. If you looked at even the rupee, it's not much. I mean, it's almost at where it was yesterday. The rupee started a bit weaker, just a bit, like 4 paise weaker. And now it has moved back to yesterday's and now it's actually 2 paise stronger. So we're not getting any cues of any weakness in the fixed income market. But let's see whether the stocks show something else, whether they copy the Asian weakness or whether they chart their own course. Markets are heavy. There's no taking away from the fact that people have gone seriously long and may not flinch from taking a bit of profit. If you looked at the PCR, that's very obvious. But the markets have to give us that call. Okay, there goes the opening bell, and it's still a little bit in the green. 0.1 in the green, 12 points higher, 9 points higher now, 7 points higher, 6 points higher. So I think this will 4 points higher now. This will count as a flat opening. 11,310, you may say, is the first tick. And on the Sensex, it's 37,600, the first tick. About 50, 60 points higher. Now it's losing a bit ground, 37,475 on the Nifty, on the Sensex. So it's red already on the Nifty Bank, down 37.43, 28,400 is holding as of now. So down just a smidge, 0.14. It's flat against an Asian screen, which is more red. So let's see if we chart a different course or we see more profit taking today. The oil marketing sensitives and PSUs, I mean, they are the same. As PSUs, they are getting hit because they'll be included in the CPSE that the government is going to sell. And therefore, there'll be a bit of shorting. And then there is an oil sensitivity. So IOC is bearing the brunt of both these trends. It's down 4.3. ONGC, again, bearing the CPSE brunt, is down almost 4%. NTPC is down 3%. Coal India, 3%. 3.5% HP, BP. So the top six stocks are either are getting beaten down either because they are PSUs or because they are oil sensitives. Vedanta, JSW, one was expecting that as the risk of wears down global commodity prices. You're seeing that impact in India as well. Z Entertainment again down 1%. Kotak Mahindra down 1%. India Bulls down. India Bulls, Tata Motors, Tata Steel, ICICI Bank are all down a little less than 1%. It's about 0.8. But balancing on the green side, you have Aisha, Wipro, DRL, Reliance. The big boy is still in the green, 0.6 up. IndusInd continues in the green, 0.6 up. ITC about 0.5%. HUL 0.5% in the green. Infosys about 0.33%. So it's all balancing out, and it's flat as flat can get. Just a shade of red, very light shade.
Okay, well, for the mid-cap index too, it's in the red. It's opened with, yes, it's opened with a 50-point cut. The market breadth is okay. It's still in favor of advances, but let's see. Things are looking a bit bleak. The aviation space is in focus. You have a SpiceJet that's down almost about 6-odd%. Jet Airways is down because of the grounding of aircrafts. And on the flip side, Indigo benefits from all of this. So Indigo is in the green at the moment. Talking about green stocks, Mahindra CIE posts that acquisition yesterday is up about 3-odd% this morning. DLF posts the upgrade is up about 2-odd%. And Apollo Tyres has come back on the buyer's radar. In fact, this week, Apollo Tyres is already up about 10%. It's gained 2% today. A couple of other stocks from the FMCG space like Nestle, Godrej Consumers, etc. are looking pretty good. Real estate stocks like Oberoi Realty, etc. are also trading in the green. So that's the list of green stocks. On the flip side, though, you do have a lot of the vulnerable names that are under pressure, like the PSU banks. Allahabad Bank falls some more. It's down about 2%. Union Bank is down 1.5%. PNB is under pressure. And the PSUs, so, you know, names like Oil India, etc. You spoke about IOC, ONGC, all under pressure right now. Coal India is also down about 2.5%. So the common theme is PSUs and PSU banks particularly are all under pressure this morning. Otherwise, it's a flat opening, Anuj. But do you get a sense that we're veering towards red? And maybe there could be some more profit booking through the day?
Let us see. The Nifty futures first bar is big red, and there are a lot of volumes traded on that. The Bank Nifty future also, you need to look at the futures first bar. That is also a big red bar, and there are big volumes being traded. If that gap gets filled, Sonia, perhaps there could be some more buying which comes back, because the you would want to buy the dip. That would be your first sort of thought process. And the mid-cap index already starting in the red, and advanced decline about to slip into the negative side. Logically, this is as good a time to take profit. You know, if you had, you should have been long on this market for some time now. But the basic reason for which you are long, that seems to be reversing at least for now, with the Asian markets also showing that that trend. So you're very, near term, very close to an important resistance mark. You want to take some money off. That's my basic call. But let's see how things move. Sudarshan, your thoughts on market opening, and is there a trade here?
Well, yes, the market has opened choppy. It went up, went down, went up, went up. I mean, that's the choppy nature of the market today. There's no fun for short-term traders in staying in this market now. You must exit and take your profits. And you rightly said, if you are still not long, then this is not the time to do anything. Just keep quiet. Exit. But this is not in short selling also. Stocks independently, I would say if you have Reliance as a short-term trader, you must take profits here. Reliance is very sensitive to crude prices, and the chances are that today's opening gap may not sustain.
Okay, well, today actually the oil marketing companies have really taken it on the chin. Mitesh, what's the new stock you may have spotted?
Yeah, Lata, I think Concord is showing good strength and continuation. The pattern is quite positive, so that's a long idea. And I would also look at Godrej Consumer. I think Sonia highlighted that. That's showing good setup of the on the indicator chart, so that should see upward traction in the coming few days.
You don't want to short any of the oil sensitives, or are they already too low?
Not aggressively. I think my belief is that overall we are in an uptrend. So I think shorting is something which I would typically avoid unless until the Nifty kind of gives away. And maybe, 30, 40 points lower down, you might see stability come in, and then shorts will not play out or will not see a big follow through. So if you're trading for an intraday basis, maybe yes. But since I trade for a slightly more positional basis, I think I would avoid shorting.
Oh yes, in fact, there are a couple of oil sensitives which are after opening higher coming off. Just pull out Apollo Tyres in first few minutes chart and you will see that. That one, in fact, is now making lows of the day. So if you can have intraday on that, that will be interesting. Prakash Kaba, any thoughts on market opening and any interesting stock idea?
Well, if I have to buy, then I'll buy only after, only even if it crosses today's high. Until that happens, I need to feel support. So will I sell it here? Book profit, that's better. It never hurts to take money off the table. But yes, I like SCL Tech. Looks like it's heading up to around 1040 zone, showing some in the initial movement, and stop below today's low of 1012.
Okay, well, Jubilant Life is the stock on our radar right now. CNBC-TV18 has accessed the warning letter for the Roorkee unit, and the U.S. Food and Drug Administration says that they have inspected the manufacturing facilities, and the warning letter summarizes a violation of the good manufacturing practices for finished pharmaceuticals. So Jubilant Life is now down about half.
Yeah, I think the market needs our attention because the mid-cap index is now seeing quite a bit of decline. 0.5% lower is what we have. Okay, gentlemen, thanks a lot for joining us and taking us through the market opening. We'll keep coming back to you. For now, Ritam Desai, head of India Equity Research and Morgan Stanley, is with us. Ritam, good morning. Thanks a lot for joining us after a long gap. You're making this point 2 weeks back that the broader market will catch up. It has, and how? And this rally feels a lot different compared to the last rally when everyone was feeling miserable. Your thoughts on whether this is start of something big?
Yes, so Anuj, if we step back and evaluate the fundamentals, I think India's fundamentals have made a trough sometime last year. And I think we are at the beginning of a new fundamental cycle. Now, these are long duration cycles. They tend to last for 5-7 years. So arguably, I would say that, you know, we are at the beginning or, you know, maybe a few months into a 5-7 year cycle in which I think we should witness pretty strong earnings growth. Mind you, corporate revenue growth has already put a trough almost 2 years ago and has been accelerating. Profits haven't for various reasons, which we'll not go through right now. But, you know, a lot of those reasons, I think, are now we're done and dusted with those. So it will not surprise me if earnings, you know, put in a 20% CAGR over the next 5 years. And then you step back and evaluate what the market is priced in. The market is not oblivious to a new earnings cycle, but certainly it cannot price in a long duration earnings cycle. What it can do is, you know, look forward, say, 6-9 months and put that into the price. So a little bit is in the price, but there's a lot more to come. And therefore, I think it's a good time to be engaged in equities. Now, there are some near-term issues, of course, with the market. The market will want to price in an election outcome. I would say that until a month ago, the market was agnostic. It was not willing to actually make a call. More recently, I think the market has started making a call that India will vote in a majority government. And if that conviction in the market grows, then I think, you know, we'll be in for a pretty powerful move in the market or a continuing powerful move until the elections. And then the setup will look very similar to 2004. And if the electorate does not surprise negatively, then I think we should see a continuation of that rally into the second half. But of course, if 2004 happens, then there could be volatility around it. So I think that's how I would picture this. The fundamental cycle is at the start of a new uptrend, which could last for a few years. Valuations are somewhere in the middle of the zone. So there is upside there. And of course, there are near-term issues around elections.
Okay, actually, good morning, Ritam. Always a pleasure having you with us. And thank you for dropping in. This comparison with 2004, I don't want to compare from the election angle. In other ways, you know, Indian growth also started picking up around 2003, and we saw that long cycle of growth. We also had a very good liquidity inflow around that time, globally as well as in India. But what does not seem to be similar to 2003 uptick in the growth cycle and now is that the global growth is not ticking along with us. There is a slowdown in global economies. Will that hurt your theory in any way?
Yeah, Lata, actually, there are quite a few dissimilarities with 2004, not only where we are in the global cycle, which I think is a pertinent point, i.e. global growth doesn't look like putting in a 5% number annually for, say, the next 3 or 4 years. It's more likely going to be 3-3.5%. So clearly, we don't have that tailwind from global factors. But we also don't have the same tailwind from valuations. Mind you, at the bottom of the 2003 cycle, the Sensex was trading at 2x book. Today, it's around 3.2x book. So it's measurably higher in terms of valuations. It doesn't have the same valuation picture. In fact, I would say 2003, both fundamentals and valuations were at bottom of the cycle. In 2019, fundamentals look like they're at the bottom, but valuations are not. Now, on your point on global growth, of course, that's going to be a headwind for India. And I therefore don't think that we will deliver the type of nifty earnings growth that we saw in that cycle. Between 2004 and 2008, Nifty earnings compounded at 30-35% per annum. And I think that's quite unlikely. I think the number is more likely to be 20%. And the reason that difference is the reason between the two periods, the difference between the two periods is this global factor, which will continue to be a bit of an overhang. So, yeah, I'm with you on that.
Okay, Ridham, hi, good morning. Just to scratch that 20% growth estimate over the next 5 years a little further, just trying to play devil's advocate here. You know, we speak to a cross-section of industries, and whether you talk to the auto guys or the power guys or even CMIE, all of them indicate that there's a slowdown underway and it may take at least 6 to 12 months before investments actually pick up. How does that tie in with your 20% earnings estimates?
So, Sonia, at the outset, you must push back on this because, you know, I said the same thing 2 years ago and we didn't get 20%. So let's have that thing on the table. And the reason, yeah, the reason I've gone so horribly wrong on the earnings cycle is because a lot of things happened in the last 2 years which we didn't anticipate. You know, to start with, Demon happened. Now, Demon happened, and then after that, I think the impact of Demon lingered on much longer than I thought. I think most of us thought that it'll be done and dusted in 6 months, but it kind of stuck around because, you know, in the meanwhile, GST got implemented. So a few things happened which went against us. I think the NPL cycle in the banking sector also lasted a tad longer. And we've seen a little longer time frame for the government to respond with infrastructure capex. Now, if I look now, I think a lot of those things are behind us. So the banking sector NPL cycle, I think, is done. We've had a pretty strong stimulus from the government in terms of spending, and therefore government capex. And we have to aggregate both SOE as well as state government and central government capex, not just central government capex. You know, together, these numbers look like they're at all-time highs relative to GDP. So they're compensating for the lack of private capital spending. Also, what has happened notably, which I don't think we should ignore, is that 2 years on, more capacity has got utilized in the private sector. So right now, I would estimate, or I should say guesstimate, that utilization rates are in the low 80s. And another 2 years, they'll be in the low 90s. Now, it's a time at which capacity needs to come on stream. So sometime in the second half this year, post-elections, I think the private sector will start debating capex. And in 2020, I think we should get some capex from the private sector as well. Now, capex or investments are very important for corporate margins. What we have not seen in the last 2 years is corporate margins. It's not lack of revenue growth. Revenue growth made a bottom a few quarters ago and is now well into double digits and has been rising sequentially quarter on quarter. What we have not seen is margins, and margins are, you know, on a macro basis heavily linked to the investment cycle. So the fact that the investment cycle, in my view, is making a comeback should augur well for margins. Now, the point you make, Sonia, on bottom-up analysis, you know, just be careful about taking corporate feedback, because companies don't know in advance that the earnings cycle is coming. They also go wrong on their guidance very often, in fact, if not. Therefore, you have to be careful about just relying on them as your cue to understanding whether earnings are coming back or not. I think the best way to do is just to step back and look at where we are in the cycle, like Howard Marks has done in his latest book last year. And when you evaluate the cycle, all I can say with some degree of confidence is that it's more likely to go up than down from where we are. And of course, then only the future will tell us what happens.
Okay. Ritham, 2 months back, this is a market which was clearly oversold, at least on the broader market side. Now, with all this dollar carry trades and, you know, ahead of elections and all that you're saying, is there a risk of this market seeing a bit of a melt up, Nifty making a move, sharp move towards, say, 11,500 to 12,000, which perhaps may not be too healthy? I mean, is there a risk of that happening? And bulls would enjoy it, but, you know.
Yeah, Anuj, you're asking. Yeah, you're asking me to make a two-month call on the market. I struggle to make even a two-year call. But anyway, let's try this. No, let's try this. So you're right, actually, in a way. I mean, if I just evaluate, a lot of things went wrong for India between, say, September and February. And actually, it should surprise most people that the Nifty was very resilient through this phase. It hardly reacted to what I would say was a pretty challenging macro environment, whether it was the banking, the non-banking sector problem, the IL&FS problem, the RBI government problem, the fact that we had, you know, liquidity problem in the system overall. A lot of things went wrong. Oil prices shot up and then, of course, went down. But a lot of things went wrong, and the Nifty should have behaved more poorly than it did. It hasn't actually behaved that poorly. In fact, if you look at it from the beginning of October now, the Nifty is actually also flat against emerging markets. So it's not that India has underperformed emerging markets. It's outperformed, then underperformed. So, and then, you know, has started to outperform again. So it did a little bit of a yo-yo, but it's remained in that range, which in itself is, I think, a bit of a positive surprise. It tells you that there was a, you know, I'm using technical terminology, there was an underlying bid waiting to happen. It was waiting for all the bad news to clear up. And indeed, they have cleared up. We got good news from the Fed. So they are not hiking anytime soon. So I think global liquidity looks a lot stronger than it was, say, 2 months ago. I think it should reflect in the way foreigners participate in India. And remember, foreign portfolio flows have been very weak in India. And as a consequence, foreign holding in India is down to 7 or 8 year lows, if you look at it from an overall portfolio perspective against the benchmark. So their positioning is quite low. It's now turning. It's just coming off lows. There's room for that to go up. I think domestic flows have been pretty resilient. Yes, of course, we've had 2 or 3 months of outflows in non-SIP funds. But overall, I think I'd take this number of 5,000 crores. And I think there's upside to that because the dust on the market seems to have settled. Okay. So to my mind, yeah, we are set up. And if the market starts believing that the electorate is going to deliver a strong outcome, then, you know, then your thesis may pan out over the next 2 months. But and of course, the market is also breaking out of the range. So technically, it looks pretty good. It could happen.
Yeah, no, equally, Anuj, if it was the other way around, I mean, if the BJP returned with a smaller majority and depended a lot more on allies, the market may give you a dip, but that by Rhythm's thesis should be a buying opportunity because that will not, ought not to hurt the growth cycle, which he thinks is clearly troughing out. That is the sense you get even from yesterday's inflation numbers. Clearly, the rural distress is declining. You have seen the food disinflation stop. Mm-hmm. That all those are looking like positive signs. But Rhythm, how do you play this? I know you will not talk stocks, but what caught my attention were 2 or 3 real estate stocks. There was an overrepresentation of real estate in the list of stocks that came in the Morgan Stanley report. And this is coinciding with CLSA also putting up a slightly bullish report on real estate. You think those assets have troughed out and we should look for good stocks in that sector?
Yes, Lata, just to add to what you told Anuj just now, I agree with you. In fact, my view in January when the elections were looking a little bit fuzzy, the election outcomes, our view was that beyond May, the market will start trading the growth cycle. So May will come and go and the ballot will fade in importance very quickly. So I would hold on to that opinion as well. On sectors, I think if I were to characterize this in one line, I think you want to buy domestic cyclicals, both consumer cyclicals and industrial cyclicals. I think both of them look quite interesting. I think income growth is looking strong and therefore consumption in the discretionary space should improve, which includes the likes of autos, airlines, it includes hotels, it includes a slew of sectors which are discretionary in nature. And then industrial cyclicals, which includes the host of industrials, engineering companies, construction companies, the big turnkey guys, everyone. So I think these are the two places that I would put money to. And then, of course, financials, where we would buy select non-banking financials. They have rallied. A lot of them have come back 20-25% from their lows in the last month. But they are still well off the tops. And I think a lot of the problems there have settled down. growth in those companies may look a little bit tepid over the next year or so as they build more liquidity and capital on their balance sheets, but I think it's more or less in the price. And then, of course, corporate banks. We're going to get very strong earnings from corporate banks. So they are, you've got to have a bid on them all the way through. They will likely get re-rated and will report strong earnings over the next 2-3 years. So that's the space we want to be. On your question on real estate, I am very bullish on real estate, both commercial and resi. Commercial, the cycle probably troughed 2 years ago and is already on its way up. Resi, I think, will likely trough in the next 1 year or so. So I think you want to buy good quality real estate companies with decent balance sheets. And I think those stocks will do quite well over the next few quarters.
Okay, well, you are not alone in that view. CLSA also has a similar view. We were speaking with Mahesh Nandurkar, and he did mention that, you know, the real estate theme is something that's going to play out. But there's another common thread that runs across all the stocks that you're overweight on, Rhythm. That's the rural theme, whether it's, you know, M&M, Maruti, Titan, Dabur, etc., Shriram Transport. Now, do you have any anecdotal evidence or research that suggests that in election years, when there is a farm income transfer or when there is a farm loan waivers, is there any incremental bump up in consumption? Because we were having this discussion, I think, with Technopac advisors a few days ago, where they suggested that there is no improvement in purchasing power, you know, when these income schemes are doled out. What does your study suggest?
Sonia, I don't think we have got such a big rural bent in our focus list. But just to step back a moment and just challenge this concept of rural India, I think, we are relying on very outdated numbers to characterize India's rate of urbanization. I think most papers put that number between 35% and 40%. I think the number is a lot higher, which is India is far more urban than it used to be. And these numbers are almost 10 years old now. And in the last 10 years, India has made, you know, pretty big advances in urbanization. So my guess, my gut feel is that this number is in the 60s now, which is rural India is a lot smaller than it used to be. And again, that portion of rural India is largely dominated now by farmers. So non-farmer rural India is a very small cohort compared to, say, 10 or 15 years ago. So we should be careful when we, you know, characterize rural India as a very big part of India's economy. Yes, the farmers are, at least in numbers, even though not in output. I mean, remember, the farmers in all are about 250 million. So they're half the workforce and they contribute just 15% of output. So they are not as productive as the rest of the nation. And they have had very poor terms of trade. Because of falling food prices. That has been a big transfer of terms of trade to urban India. So urban India is actually looking much better than it was, say, 7-8 years ago when it was dealing with high food price inflation and high generalized inflation. Today, urban India has actually got this big transfer of terms of trade, unfortunately from very poor farmers. So therefore, it is only fair to transfer some of that money back to farmers, which is what I think the government has done. There could be a lot of debate on this with respect to its fiscal impact, inflation impact. But I think just in the context of fairness, I think it is the right thing to do. And these farmers, I think, with the cash that they will receive or are already receiving, should see some pickup in their ability to consume. So I think the outlook does look a little better. Mind you, this did not exist in previous election cycles because we didn't attempt cash transfers in previous election cycles, but we only did subsidies. So this is very different in its nature. Cash is very different from subsidizing things. Cash gives the power of spending discretion to the farmer. And therefore, there should be some pickup in the so-called rural demand. But it's a lot smaller part of the Indian economy than it used to be.
How important is crude as a risk factor for this market? Because while, you know, right now we are enjoying a liquidity sort of factor, that's also pushing up crude prices. We saw last time our market underperformed because of this being a very big factor.
More generally, I wanted to add, Rhythm, yeah, what are the risks to your theory itself?
Yeah. No, I think, Anuj, thank you for raising it, because I think in the middle of all this, even I lost the point. I was going to make the point on oil. So I think actually that a lot of India's underperformance in the first 6 weeks of this year against emerging markets was because oil rose relative to copper. Now, I don't look at oil prices on an absolute basis. The reason is that oil prices rise for two reasons. One is because global demand is strong. Second is because there is supply disruption in the oil market. How do you isolate that? You isolate that by taking another commodity which will also respond to similar factors. And when oil is outperforming copper, it means it's going up largely because of supply factors rather than demand factors. When the demand factor is there, it will be there for both copper and oil, and then you will not see such outperformance. So the fact is that oil has outperformed copper, and that's not good news for India, because that means that there are, you know, some supply constraints in the market. And whenever that happens, India does tend to underperform. I think it remains a risk factor in the short run for the next 2-3 months. If the market gets, say, jittery about the election outcome in the next few weeks, and that's always possible because, you know, things keep changing in an election period quite violently. And if oil is going up, then your argument on a melt up could change very quickly. So I would definitely keep a corner of my eye on oil. Longer term, I think oil will reduce in importance because its share in India's GDP will keep declining over the, say, next 3 to 5 years. But it's certainly a short-term factor to keep an eye on. And Lata, on your point, I think global growth is clearly something that we should watch out for, especially in the context of US and China trade. I wouldn't underestimate a trade war's ability to disrupt global factors and therefore India's growth rate. And I think we should also keep an eye on inflation impulse in India. I think it's not being considered right now because headline inflation has been so well controlled. But, you know, it goes back to my point at the start of this conversation, which is I think utilization rates are rising. Mm. And what happens when that happens? Pricing power comes back. So I won't be surprised to see pricing improve across a host of sectors. Now, that will, of course, be accompanied with strong earnings, which is why I'm bullish on earnings. But it also comes with headline inflation. So I think we should keep an eye on that as well.
Okay. All right. I take your point entirely. We are beginning to see the disinflation troughing out, as you know, we were just discussing, both in food and in core inflation. Even core inflation compared to Jan was higher in February. Take your point entirely. We're underestimating the swing, just as we underestimated the downswing in disinflation. We could be underestimating the upswing as well. Anuj, you were going to say something?
No, I think Timsi is breaking an important story on real estate. I think it's perhaps seen a bit negative for real estate. The ITC unused as on March 31 will be reversed by the real estate developers through GSTR 3B return form, and the ITC benefit available to the real estate developers will hence lapse since it cannot be passed on to the buyers. So that's
housing costs will go up.
So it looks like, you know, positive trade, you know, you started to see real estate stocks actually go down a bit. Let's flash that story. Stocks like DLF, Oberoi Real Estate, actually seeing a bit of a decline from the high point. In fact, Timsi has sent us this toss. Let's hear her out.
Well, that's right. What we understand from sources as of now is the fact that the agenda is almost set for the upcoming GST Council meeting. And the GST Law and Fitment Committee has proposed that the only way forward for a smooth transition on real estate, that is from old rates to the new lower rationalized rates, is that the ITC on the input of goods and services, which is lying unused as on 31st March 2019, should be reversed by real estate developers through their return form, that is GSTR 3B. And government feels that the ITC benefit available to the real estate developers will actually lapse and die over there itself. And from 1st April 2019, any new invoice raised by the builders will have to be charged at 1% for affordable housing, again without ITC, and at 5% without ITC for other than affordable housing. Now, remember, the 34th GST Council is all set to meet on March 19 to finalize the transition norms for the reduced rates on real estate. Now, meanwhile, the government has also assessed an impact of this change. And this assessment actually is a little worrisome for the home buyers, because the cost of affordable housing could go up and the cost of luxury housing could drop once this transition happens. Also, developers might go in for repricing of projects, and it will be tough for the government to track the procurement clause that they have put in, which says that 80% of procurement needs to be done by registered dealers. Also, this entire scheme of things might result in a sudden increase of anti-profiteering complaints. So it's a mixed bag that government will have to take a tough call on in the upcoming GST Council meeting. We'll keep you posted.
All right. Thank you very much for that, Tim C. Already we are beginning to see a little bit of an impact on the real estate stocks. The input tax credit, we keep saying ITC, the input tax credit which they assumed now has to be reversed. So they will pass on that cost of, you know, the tax credit that they took, but which they cannot now take, to the price of the home. And therefore, chances of buyers being put off or staying away a little or buying, you know, lower houses, lower priced houses rather than higher priced houses could happen. It's a sentimental, it's an important negative for affordable home buyers or affordable home builders, or so it seems.
By the way, bank Nifty is surging, Lata. I just wanted to make a point. Fresh all-time high for Bank Nifty. The dip has been bought and how? Mm. Just look at the chart of the Bank Nifty. Axis Bank and HDFC Bank are really propelling that move. Just see both these stocks right now, intraday, and the Bank Nifty hitting all-time high. That's the move that we are spotting right now.
Yeah, actually, throughout the time when we were talking to Rhythm, the markets were reversing and eating up all their losses. The dips were getting bought. You know, Rhythm, we didn't discuss IT with you, and that was for a reason. Because one of your top mid-cap IT picks, Cyient, is a management whom we have invited. So we request you to stay on with us. Mr. Ajay Agarwal, the president and CFO of Cyient, is with us. And if you wish, you also, of course, can add your questions to ours. So do stay on. It'll be our pleasure to listen to your questions as well. Mr. Agarwal, good morning to you. Thank you for your patience. Well, first up, your guidance, I mean, you know, NASSCOM did not give a guidance because they are still cautious or confused about FY20. You cut your guidance. At this juncture, how does FY20 look to you as we stand at the end of FY19?
Thank you, Lata, for having me in. Good morning to you and everybody. And my greetings to Rhythm if he's still around. If you look at, before I go to 20, as far as 19 is concerned, we had talked about extensively on what is happening in financial year 19 and had given an outlook. We are on track for financial year 19. And you would see that, you know, as we exit financial year 19 in quarter four, that's going to be, you know, one of the best quarters for us. In terms of growth, in terms of other parameters. And in terms of financial year 20, I think at the end of the quarter four, we will have the earnings call, we'll talk about it. But I can say that, you know, looking at some of the things, you know, we have seven verticals and three largest verticals are aerospace, communication, utilities and GIS. I think each of these are seeing a better outlook for the next year. So I have no reason to believe that we should not have an outlook for next year which is going to be better than the current year.
Okay. Rhythm, you want to go ahead and ask Mr. Agarwal any questions?
No, I don't want to ask questions. Should I leave now or you want me to stay on?
But it would be nice if you can take a question on IT. We just have to ask a few more questions of Mr. Agarwal. if you don't mind, we would like you to stay on.
But Lata, I don't want to ask a question. I don't mind staying on, but I don't want to ask a question.
Sure. Okay. All right, Rhythm. In fact, thank you for joining
us. Thank you, Rhythm, for being
us.
So kind to me.
Agarwal, good morning. I want to take that point forward about your guidance. On the margin front,
yes.
The FY19 margins, you know, you had spoken about how they'll be flat to marginally higher. But earlier on, you had guided for a 50 basis points margin expansion. What do you see as the margin trajectory? Are there any pressures that could impact margins in the quarters to come?
I think if you look at our margin, you have to look at two or three things. That, you know, broadly as a company, I think we are tracking at about 14% margin for last few years, if you see. And whatever have been the headwinds from the salary side, I think we have been able to make it out either because of the exchange rate or maybe because of, you know, some of the efficiencies. But as we get into the new year, I would say that, you know, there are two things we are working on. One is if you look at our services margin, which is 90% of our business, we are there at about 15.5%. We are trying to work on certain initiatives so that, you know, how can we move and and get back to the original levels of 18% plus margin in services. So that's one initiative currently we are undertaking. And also we are trying to see that, you know, whatever is the difference in the margin between our services business and rest of the investments, that's also narrowing down. So as a combination of these two, while the headwinds will continue in the coming years in terms of the wage hike, and we can't predict about the rupee to dollar equation, we are very confident that we should see a quantum improvement in our services margin. And that should lead to a substantial improvement in our margin in coming years.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Mr. Agarwal, will Brexit impact you? Because you all just won a UK electricity order as well. I assume you are exposed to Europe as well. If there is a slowdown in both these places because of the disruption, does that lower your expectations from FY20?
See, if you look at it from the perspective of Brexit, I think some of them are customer specific issues in terms of some of them are growing, some of them are not growing, so well. I would say from the Brexit perspective, I think both on the presence of our people in terms of legal and contractual requirements, we don't have any specific issues. But I think as such on Europe, we have acquired one more entity, which is in Belgium, outside of UK. And I think that's also driving our growth. So overall, I see that, you know, the growth will continue in Europe, including in UK.
So when you say that you're confident of getting back to the 18% margins for the services business, what does that mean for the blended margins of the company? Currently, I think you're sitting at sub 15%. What could be the range as we go ahead?
So if you look at that, you know, there is about 1% narrowing down, which takes place because we have high single digit margin, or I would say about 4-5% margin on our manufacturing business and some other investments. So that would mean something like 17% for the overall business. But as I said, we are working on that particular initiative. It is a 12-15 month program that we are undertaking, which will complete by end of financial year 20. And some of them in terms of the initiatives and this precise impact, we will talk about when we have the earnings presentation. So you have to give me the benefit. I'm just trying to, since you asked me about, you know, what are our thoughts on margin, we are taking it very seriously. And we are working on special initiative to improve the margins.
All right, Mr. Agarwal. Definitely, we will get a much better insight during your earnings call. And thank you very much indeed for joining us this morning. Rhythm, that was the final question to you. Okay, all right, we'll get to Rhythm in a bit. The important takeaway coming from Scient is that they are very, very serious about their margins and not terribly worried, it looks like, because of Brexit either. On that note, let's take a break because we have to pay attention to the market. The Nifty Bank has just shot up to 0.7% higher. So it's 200 points higher, and with each passing moment, of course, it's setting new highs for itself. We have to discuss the markets. We are back with our technical experts in a minute.